I've seen indication that those with diabetes, type 2 diabetes, are the most likely to succumb to complications from this virus. The numbers are small, but very strong. Thank you, Dr. Brewer. And that's Thomas Gronick. So Thomas, yes, that's a big, big deal. And if you look at our channel started 4 years ago, and it was focused on people that have diabetes and especially unrecognized prediabetes. As you'll see, if you start scrolling through the comments on our channel, two or three times a month, somebody says, you know, doc, I decided to start taking your test. They're talking, most of the time when they say this, they're talking about an OGTT, oral glucose tolerance test, and even an insulin survey. If you haven't heard of insulin survey, it's glucose tolerance test, but you measure insulin as well. You can look up Joseph Kraft, K-R-A-F-T, insulin survey. And here's what you find. And here's what the majority of my practice and the majority of my channel is. People like that saying, I don't have prediabetes. I've got full-blown diabetes. And my doc's been telling me every year, I'm fine. I don't have a problem. So that's the thing. If we think we have an epidemic of obesity or an epidemic of diabetes, we haven't seen anything yet until we start looking at the epidemic of undiagnosed prediabetes. Now, why did I go there? Number one, because that's a major component of this channel. And number two, what you're hearing from the CDC right now is you have significant risk if you have full-blown type 2 diabetes with complications. That tends to be the continued gospel that you hear in medical circles. The bottom line, though, is this. Prediabetes is the very, very same disease process. It's just a matter of degree. The difference between prediabetes and diabetes is a blood sugar of 190 is still prediabetes, but over 200 is full-blown diabetes. A fasting blood sugar of 120 is still prediabetes, and over 126 is full-blown diabetes. So that's the difference between prediabetes and diabetes. And you say, well, it's clearly a matter of how much damage it's doing, right? And prediabetes is not doing damage. It's not messing up your immune system. It's not putting you at increase for risk for COVID-19, et cetera, right? Well, go back, take a look at the science that we know about tissue damage and prediabetes. By the time people get a diagnosis of full-blown type 2 diabetes, between one-third and two-thirds already have diabetic damage to their eyes. And about a third already have some evidence of neurologic damage. So one-third of what you see with full-blown diabetes. So the point is, yes, there are a lot of us with prediabetes. And no, having prediabetes instead of full-blown diabetes really doesn't mean that you're safe. You need to be aware. Now, what portion of people are aware? Well, when you look back 5 or 6 years ago, the CDC was saying there are about a third of adults in America have prediabetes. And according to the CDC at that point, only about 8 million knew about it. So 90% of us that have this disease process prior to full-blown diagnosis, full-blown type 2 diabetes, only 10% of us know it. Well, there's very good reason now to believe that those numbers are way low. If you start looking at the UCLA study, for example, they said it's not a third, it's a half. And it's not starting at age 60, it's starting at age 30. And even the UCLA study didn't, it just looked at fasting blood glucose and hemoglobin A1C for the most part. Most of the people that are responding on this channel and saying, I've got full-blown diabetes or I've got way significant prediabetes, they have been followed already with hemoglobin A1C and fasting glucose. So there's a significant epidemic of prediabetes out there. There's plenty of evidence that prediabetes injures your tissues, like your retina, your eyes, your nerves. So who's to say that prediabetes doesn't cause increased risk for COVID-19? I certainly wouldn't put my money on that. Lay face down is pneumonia. Not sure what you're talking about there. I think you may be meaning that once you get into acute respiratory distress syndrome, they have found a few things that greatly improve your survival in the ICU. And again, somebody fact check, somebody help me in terms of it's MedCram. They've got some really good stuff for those of you that want to get technical. A couple of months ago, MedCram covered some of the recent developments in terms of managing sepsis and specifically ARDS, having people on the respirator in ICU. And I think he specifically did go into some mention about COVID-19. So what happens with COVID-19 in your lungs is your lungs get inflamed. The air sacs or alveoli, the space around those air sacs becomes flooded. So that extra water sort of pushes them in. What we find that we have to do in the ICU is blow those sacs open. That helps immensely. That takes a mortality rate from 42% down to about the mid-30s. But the problem that happens next is that use pressure to blow that alveoli completely back up, you cause more inflammation. So they do minimal level. Now, in order to do that minimal level, your brain doesn't trust that. So your brain is fighting the ventilator. So they have to paralyze you. And as Billy the Weasel said a second ago, I think this is what Billy was talking about. They have also found that flipping you over on your stomach for this is a significant improvement in mortality. So you do those three things, flipping them over on their stomach, doing the lower ventilation levels, the lower tidal volume levels, paralyzing you. Those three things take a mortality rate in the 40s down to the mid-teens. So significant improvement there. We continue to get great feedback regarding the webinars, and here's why. You know, on the internet, when you hear a webinar, you expect for somebody to try to sell you something. We're not doing that. We're trying to tell you something. People are coming in with their labs from Quest, inflammation panel, OGTT, insulin survey response, and then they're finding out, do I have inflammation? Do I have insulin resistance? And where does that fit in terms of other folks? We're getting ready to start one for CIMT as well. So again, people are really excited about finding out their own status. Looking forward to seeing you there. Thanks.